Today's episode of This Week in Startups is brought to you by Squarespace, the all-in-one platform that makes it fast and easy to create a professional website and now an online store. For a free trial and 10% off your first purchase on new accounts, go to squarespace.com and use the offer code TWIST. And by PagerDuty, serving as the hub of your operations, aggregating all of your infrastructure, monitoring tools, and alerting the right people and teams at the right time. Sign up today at pagerduty.com/twist. And get a free t-shirt when you get your first alert. And by AWS Activate, the Amazon Web Services startup program. It's easy to start and scale your business with AWS. Visit aws.amazon.com/activate.
Hey everybody, today on the program, the CEO of Glu Mobile. If you haven't heard of that name, you have heard of Kim Kardashian, Hollywood. Yes, this is the insane game that is tearing up the App Store charts. It's making like $40 million a quarter. It's gonna make hundreds of millions of dollars. Kim Kardashian is personally involved in writing the copy and approving everything. Like, Kim Kardashian's making a game on a weekly basis, sending dozens of emails. And we talk with the CEO of the company who landed Kim Kardashian to do this groundbreaking game that is become a huge, huge phenomenon. I mean, in fact, Kim Kardashian may make more from this game than any other thing she does, television, fashion, etc. It's an amazing discussion about the future of gaming, of celebrities involved in startups. A great hour with a really smart guy. Stick with us.
It's what it's all about, man. They said money is the root of all evil. What? Funny how it feeds my people. We ain't gonna live like equals until we get the money, spend the money and defeat you. Yeah. Money is the root of all evil. What? Funny how it feeds my people. Yeah. We ain't gonna live like equals until we get the money, spend the money and defeat you.
Hey everybody, it's Jason Calacanis, and this is This Week in Startups, the show where we talk about entrepreneurship, building products and services, making a dent in the universe. And one of the major fundamental shifts of the last 10 years, as we all know, has been mobile. And if you look at the statistics, what are people doing with their smartphones? Everybody thinks, oh my God, it's a smartphone, so you're doing like phone stuff. No, nobody's using their phone anymore. Then you think, oh, it's communications. Communications is the big thing. Yeah, people are using Facebook, they're using Twitter. That's all very important. However, what's happened on mobile phones and tablets is that they have become the new game consoles. And you only need to open up the App Store to realize that games are a huge, huge business. Huge. And if you look at iPads, the iPad, everybody thinks it's for magazines, whatever. The iPad's a video game console. I mean, the statistics and then of the number of minutes people play of games on tablets is off the charts. And on mobile phones, it's a huge percentage. We're talking 30, 40, 50%, depending on the user, of time is gaming. And it's amazing as well because these people did not buy Xboxes, PlayStations, Nintendo, Wiis. It's a whole new group of people playing games. So the smartphone and the mobile revolution is as much about gaming as it is about communication, but you don't hear about it all that much. Well, today on the program, I have got the guy who has quietly built one of the largest companies in the space. And I became super aware of you, of course, because of this Kim Kardashian thing, which nobody can stop talking about. So welcome to the program, Niccolo de Masi. I pronounced
pleasure
it correct, right?
Absolutely.
All right. So now, Niccolo, you have this company, Glu Mobile. You've been doing mobile games since 2000-something.
2001. Glu was founded in 01, actually.
Wow.
Public since March 07. I'm just finishing my fifth year there.
Fantastic. So tell me first about this Kim Kardashian game, because I'm going to play the trailer now. And this is the thing everybody's talking about, because I said, this is how I produced the show. I'm like, whoever the guy is who did this Kim Kardashian thing is a genius. Find me the guy, right? So you work backwards from product.
Sure.
And so I don't want to reduce your whole career to this Kim Kardashian game, but boy, has this become a phenomenon. Mm-hmm. I'm playing it now in the background for those of you who are watching on the video. If you're just listening, you can see a beautifully animated Kim Kardashian talking to her sister or somebody. What is this game, and why has it become such a phenomenon?
Well, the game's actually really quite deep in its own right.
Okay.
And I think what's made it the phenomenon it is the fact that we're merging great gameplay and depth with her brand, and we're blurring the lines between the real world and the virtual world,
okay,
ultimately.
So what do people do in this game? What is the goal of the game? And what is the game mechanic that's made it so addictive and massively profitable? From what I understand, this is like hundreds of millions of dollars a year. I mean, you're a public company, so I think you've released these figures. What does a game like this do in revenue?
Well, what we've released is, approximations of what it's made so far in the first quarter.
Okay.
We just had our Q3 earnings in November. We said that the Kim game made something like $43 million of gross consumer expenditure revenue.
Wow.
Right? So Apple keeps their cut.
Yeah.
Then we're paying hosting costs, development costs, marketing costs.
Got it.
Then Kim's got a royalty off of that.
Right.
The game is actually unique, I would say, 2D RPG narrative engine.
Okay.
And so what you're doing in the game is
so Kim, say that in English for people who don't know. Yeah. What is that? Right. RPG
sort of
narrative.
Break it down. What I think about the game along the following lines. It's basically the digital analog of those choose your own adventure novels you might have read as a kid.
Of course, right. Yeah.
We've all read those. You know, go to page 7 if you want to slice the samurai's head off. And,
right.
You know, if that's just the male version.
Do you want
right?
to pick up the sword or do
exactly.
you want to pick up the axe?
Exactly. And... So it's kind of a clever way of doing that for this generation.
Mm-hmm.
Except what you're doing in the game is you're working your way up from, you know, let's say waiter or waitress to the B-list, eventually the A-list in Hollywood.
Right.
Kim is coaching you through the game on how you should take your first job, who you should decide to work with.
Right.
And the players get to decide who they date, whether they should work with this, director or that director. And I think it's very aspirational, actually, to three different demographics.
Okay.
So there's Kim followers, fans of her, 30, 40 million Facebook, Twitter, Instagram followers that are playing. There's people that like Hollywood that are playing. And there's a third interesting group of young ladies who probably like the adult decision-making in the game that it allows.
Ah. In a way, you know what it reminds me of? Do you remember the game Leisure Suit Larry when we were kids? That I'm assuming you're 30, 40 years old.
Yeah.
There was a game Leisure Suit Larry. It was just a guy who was going out on dates or whatever. And it was like rated R, but it was more adult in theme. And it was this kind of like storytelling. But when you look at a game like this, what role does Kim's fan base have? Because I think she's very underestimated.
Mm-hmm.
I was just at the Art Basel thing in Miami, and there was a dinner for her for Paper Magazine, obviously the big photo spread that broke the internet. When I left, it was one thing to see her come into a room. Like, she came into this room. There were 200 people in it. Literally, like, 50 photographers from all sides. It was like a tsunami came into the Paper Magazine party. But more interestingly, when I left, there were no less than 75 kids downstairs waiting for Kim Kardashian to take pictures with her. I mean, it was amazing. They were like waiting for hours to see her.
Yeah.
What is it about her and her fan base that made this such a phenomenon? Because I don't know that anybody would have predicted this.
I think that's fair.
Yeah.
The game really has so many different layers to it, and the experience has so many different layers to it that I think sort of in totality they're all pulling together to create this great breakout hit.
Right.
People love the authenticity of Kim.
Ah.
And this is a big, I think, underestimated phenomenon that underpins the game but also her own brand and popularity.
Right.
Kim really does her own social media. She walks around with, a phone or two, takes all these pictures herself. She's writing all this stuff herself. She's not sort of delegating or outsourcing to some other creative team.
Mm.
And so when you're playing the game or you're following Kim on social media, you really are following from the horse's mouth, so to speak.
Right.
And I think whether or not you're a kid or whether or not you're a photographer, people can appreciate the fact that I actually think I would characterize Kim as probably the world's first truly successful transmedia brand, if you think about it. So
yeah.
I think our game is the first successful transmedia game in the sense that she, her virtual world and her real world are very, very close together now. They're intertwined.
Right.
Her social media world is intertwined with her real world. And so you have these three kind of platforms. You have Kim in physical form, you have Kim in social media form, and now you have Kim in interactive form.
And you also have Kim in traditional media too, like there's actually that fourth dimension, which is she has a TV show or like magazines or she just sort of like appears there as well.
Correct. And I think she's masterfully woven them all together, and she does a good job of catering for each platform independently, but making sure that they all can relate and play off of each other.
Got it.
And she's incredibly disciplined, believe it or not. She's the best partner that we've had at Glu. She and I work together on every single update, approval, you name it, extension of the game, brainstorming. She's very involved. She maintains authenticity in every single character, and even every word in the game is approved by her, believe it or not. So
that's extraordinary, because that was you anticipated my next question, which was, how involved is Kim in this? Is it just like, yeah, you can make my game, throw my, I'm LeBron James, make LeBron James basketball. I'm Kobe, make Kobe, whatever, 2K, basketball. She is literally in a room with you, or you sent her copy and she just writes back on her BlackBerry, like, change this line, change that line. Really?
It's all the above. I mean, we talk once in a while on the phone, meet in person monthly, maybe, or quarterly, but emails can be as many as half a dozen a day.
Oh my God.
So there is a constant stream of, you know, back and forth on what else we could do with the game, a rolling roadmap of who we're going to introduce in terms of new characters, new locations, her travel schedule. And yes, she's approving the copy in the game, the characters, look and feel, the narrative. And this is unique, right? You're absolutely correct that everybody else in the past that has done a gaming partnership or a Hollywood partnership has been very passive. And clearly, there's a very big difference in that.
Everything's a licensing deal, and you don't even get to the person. It's not like you're going to even ever talk to them. You just pay them a fee, and that's it. You're done. All right, when we get a commercial break, back from commercial break, I want to know how you landed this deal, because right now, everybody, like, I never met you. You just seem to be like a hardworking guy with your head down, but everybody in Silicon Valley is going like, who did this game, and how did they land Kim Kardashian? Now, everybody's trying to repeat it. So when we get back, I want to find out how you actually got to Kim Kardashian and convinced her to do a game that's now making over $100 or will make over $100 million a year, maybe $200 million a year. Who knows? When we get back on This Week in Startups. I've been using Squarespace for 5 or 6 years now. I love Squarespace. We use Squarespace for everything we do. Launch Festival, the Launch Fund, the Launch Incubator, when we do a scale conference, everything we do. We use Squarespace. Why? Because one, I want a beautiful website. Two, I don't want to hire a bunch of developers and designers to roll their own website and then have them disappear. And then I have to hire another person. They say, oh, I don't use Ruby. I use Python. Or I don't use Python. I use .NET or whatever. And then all of a sudden you're down in this trap and it's costing you days and weeks of time and thousands of dollars to update your website. No, you just pay one simple price for the most beautiful websites in the world, which is Squarespace. Squarespace is literally the Rolls Royce, the Lamborghini, the Ferrari, the Tesla of website hosting and management. They make the most beautiful templates, and they have all these other features. And they just did this Squarespace 7 interface. I mean, they're really like, these guys and gals over there are like design legends. They're awesome. But it integrates with Google Apps. So, hey, you know, you got Google Apps and everybody's at your domain name. You can all log in and it's super easy. They've got a partnership with Getty Images so you can put some images on your website. Ah, you don't have to hire another developer designer to go handle that nonsense and open up an account with Getty Images. Tons of new templates, beautiful design, simple, powerful, 24-hour support and live chat. That's critical because you don't need a technical person in your company to update your website anymore. No. I'd literally say to people, please put up a website for the Launch Incubator. Please put up a website for the Launch Fund. And you know what they do? Within like 15 minutes, they come back and they say, hey, boss, here's two or three options that are gorgeous. And I'm like, that's amazing. What are those going to cost? $10,000? Do we pay a designer? It's like, no, we're paying $8 a month. Ridiculous $8 a month. Squarespace, you are selling yourself short. You are too generous. Should be $80 a month. I literally would pay $80 a month. But if you want to charge me $8, that's fine. Oh, yeah. And by the way, it's all responsive design. So you don't have to worry about when people pull out their phone or their tablet that they're pinching and zooming to try to read what's on your website. They also do commerce. I know that they have like a commerce widget where you can just have your own store on there. They have a calendar. So what happens is they keep adding features and making life better and better and better for the people who host their websites with them, which means those people never leave, which means they have a bigger base of revenue, which means they invest more in the platform, and the virtuous cycle continues for Squarespace, making them the most elite place for you to host your website. Period. Done. This is what I use. This is what you should use. Anybody says to you, website, I need to put up a website, you say Squarespace. They say, I want to build a beautiful website. You think and you say, try Squarespace. Go ahead and use the offer code TWIST and you will get 10% off your first purchase. Support This Week in Startups and go create a Squarespace site. You can start here and go anywhere. I like that tagline, Squarespace. Start here, go anywhere. They've been a long-term sponsor of the show, you know that, and I've been a huge fan of the product. And we gotta get the founder back on the show. He hasn't been on the show in a couple of years. Let's book it. Squarespace is awesome. Thank you, Squarespace. You guys do a great job. Hey, everybody. Welcome back to This Week in Startups. My guest today, Niccolo de Masi, NiccoloDeMasi on the Twitter. And Glu Mobile, pretty easy to find, GLU Mobile on Twitter and glu.com, GLU.com. Now, this company is huge. You got 650 people working there, on a bunch of different continents, 4 or 5 continents.
Correct.
And you make a bunch of games. We'll get into those in a minute. Some of them are amazing looking. I mean, it looks like you're watching a PlayStation or an Xbox, and we'll get into that, of how powerful these processors are getting. But everybody wants to know, how did you get... how did you get Kim Kardashian? Because we assume, like, if you want to get a celebrity, you can write a check, and every celebrity's got a price. But how did you get to Kim Kardashian and then get her so engaged in this? That's, I think, whatever you did there, whoever on your team did that, that's the magic. How did you get to Kim and get her engaged in building an authentic, real product?
Sure. Well, the simple answer is, it was my idea, my deal. Yeah. We took an existing game engine that we had been working on since 2011. Mm. So for 2 or 3 years, we've been refining this narrative RPG structure, this choose-your-own-adventure, but for the mobile gaming generation. And we thought, I thought, what could we do to turbocharge it, basically? How do we 10x the audience, at least? Or maybe 20x the audience. And ultimately, you come up with a short list of brands and personalities and options. She was the top of my list, ultimately because I thought that the fit between what her fans want as well as what her brand is and what this game could be was the closest. I also ultimately thought that we should chase after the best in the world. And through all of my personal time into getting in touch with her agents, and then eventually her agents would get in touch with her mother, who's her manager.
Right.
And I ended up on the phone, believe it or not, with Kim, maybe 18, 20 months ago, originally talking about the concept we had, showing her some of the creatives we had, and talking through the timelines and what the game could be. And she got the concept really quickly, which I thought boded well for how the partnership could work. I think having chemistry, between principals is important.
Right.
And her seeing the sort of commitment from Glu was, from sort of the top down, probably gave her a lot of confidence that we'd be doing our utmost to make this critically successful and commercially successful ultimately.
And she's a major partner in this. So in other words, people have been talking all around that she's making a lot of money. We can assume that she may – is it public how much – what percentage she gets as her part of this, or we can just assume it's some double-figure number?
Yeah, it's not public. I mean, what we've announced is the percentage of total Glu revenues that are being paid in royalties.
Got it.
And that number is about 12% in Q3.
Right.
Off of a revenue base of, I think, $83, $84 million.
Right.
Now, of the total royalties paid, you can assume that she's, keeping the largest chunk of them.
Right.
Given that that game is the most successful royalty game in there.
Sure. So she's going to make millions and millions of dollars off of this pretty easily, it looks like.
Mm-hmm.
So that... Is it? I think it's conceivable that Kim Kardashian could make more money working with Glu than almost any other top opportunity that she has. I don't know what she gets paid for a television show. I'm assuming tens of millions.
Yeah.
But this is millions. It sounds like it could be tens of millions.
Mm-hmm.
What does that say about platforms?
Yeah.
That your modest Silicon Valley company with 650 people is now Kim Kardashian's focus when she's got television studios and everybody chasing her, but her attention is the precious commodity here, and she seems pretty engaged in this. And this could do the same amount of revenue for her than television. It's amazing.
Yeah, I don't know exactly what her other deals are, but I think TV, fashion, gaming are probably all, in the top, on the podium anyway.
Yeah.
Credit to Kim for making that happen and seeing that potential, right?
Yeah.
Because she rapidly threw herself behind the project and recognized the fact that this could be integral as a communication platform for her to her fans, as a way of allowing her fans to feel closer to her when she's not on TV. So you get to pick up the game, play 5 minutes, play 10 minutes, any time of the week you want, 24/7. You don't have to wait for the show to be on.
Mm.
And so the average gamer is actually playing this about 5 times a day, 5 or 6 minute sessions, something like that.
People are putting sort of a half 30, hour a day? Just what?
Well, on average, yeah. Something like that. It's those
What do the whales do? Because this is always fascinating to me. What does the top 10% do? Just generally speaking, broad strokes in a game like this.
I mean, they play much more, but most of all, they spend money.
Yeah, explain that.
Yeah, so, free-to-play games, you understand how they work.
Sure, you download it for free, you play a little bit, and then it tells you, give me money to get whatever, special outfits or something, or swords.
Well, actually...
Or time.
Yeah, I mean, ultimately, you're deciding your own demand curve of time versus money. And this is why the business model is so efficient, because every individual player can say, I'll spend a dollar to go faster, or I'll put the time in. So it's like individualized demand curves. What most people don't realize is this is not the try versus buy model. This is not the shareware model.
Right.
This is really a brand new business model in the last half decade to a decade where 95% of people don't ever spend a dime. Mm. But you can play the game for hundreds of hours and get very, very far in it.
Right.
It's the 1 to 5% in a game that spend. And within the 1 to 5% that spend, there's another power law within that of how much they spend.
Right.
So there's a top 10% of the spenders probably spend hundreds of dollars in the game.
Right.
And there might be a top 1% in the spenders that might even spend $1,000 in the game.
Wow.
And that's what makes the overall experience interesting is advertising seen by 95%, 5% spend something or 10% or 1%. It's a small number spending
anything.
Right. But there's sort of the whales in there that want to be the best and they're very competitive.
And leaderboards and things like that drive them. They want to be on the top leaderboard, et cetera.
Want to be on the A-list in this case.
You want to be on the A-list in this case. And so what's the most a person would spend on a game like this in a month or something?
We haven't disclosed what the top whale is, but in most Glu games, and we've said this before on my earnings calls, you know, we don't have whales that have spent, you know, these six-figure numbers you might have heard of other companies.
That's crazy.
It is impressive. It's impressive, to say the least. Most of our games, I think a whale would be defined as $1,000, not $10,000 or $100,000 over their life.
Over their life. Yeah. And $1,000, if this is your passion.
Right.
Not really that much money. I mean, people spend hundreds of thousands of dollars going to Vegas, or they might spend thousands of dollars going to concerts or following the Dead or Bruce Springsteen around town. It's not – or buying season tickets to a football game or whatever. It'd be thousands of dollars. So it's not actually that much money. But people do get a little judgmental about that whale thing, I guess.
Well, they do because they think that people are spending that money in one go, and you're right. Wow. In reality, when we throw these numbers out, we're talking about the lifetime engagement. So you might have people that are whales that have been playing this game now for 6 months. They might be playing it an hour or two a day. So if you break it down per hour of entertainment, you know, you
might 50 hours a month, and they've spent $200 or $4 an hour, which is the same, which is half the price of a movie.
Correct. And that's the main advantage of gaming, is whether or not you're looking at console or free-to-play, any platform, the per-hour cost of entertainment is probably the lowest in the world.
Yeah, because the replay value is so high, the games are so rich, it takes so long to finish a Call of Duty or Kim Kardashian's game, whatever it is. It just takes a long time.
Correct.
What do you think, though, about these other games where we've had these reports? You know, what, maybe the 100,000 is not even true, but if there was people spending, you know, $50,000, do you think, like, oh, my God, that's like – it's almost like the person at the casino, you have to tell them, like, you really shouldn't be spending this kind of money. Should there be, like, some sort of cap on this? Or
so there's two phenomena there. Yeah. I think, you know, even games like Farmville at Zynga, I think once, you know, in the past, they've certainly talked of numbers that big, I think, in their IPO roadshow.
Yeah.
Whenever you have 50 million people doing something, there's always extremist and, right? There's always going to be 0.001% that, you know, make this their life, passion, hobby. And they might also have a lot of disposable income.
Right.
So when you break that down, if you spend $100,000 in a game over 2 years, it means you're spending a few hundred dollars every weekend.
Yeah.
So that could be your equivalent of, instead of going to the bar, I play, you know, this game and my friends are playing the game and I'm competing with them and I want to beat them, or I want to be the best, or I want to make my guild or my clan the best.
Right.
So when you break it down like that, I don't think there's anything that anyone should be concerned about in terms of, you know, addiction, for
example. That's what I was saying. The word addiction comes to mind. Yeah.
It does come to mind, but, you know, to be fair, almost every activity in the world has people that are passionate, very addicted to it. You know, the entire media entertainment space, you know, ultimately has whales in every single bit of the sector, including probably watching this program, I would think.
Absolutely. You know, there are people who have watched all 500 episodes.
There you go.
To them, I say, I am sorry. All right, when we get back from this commercial break, I want to talk to you about the power of the platform, because I'm holding up my iPhone 6 Plus here. I mean, the power in these devices
it's phenomenal.
Since 2007 has been nothing short of phenomenal. And I want you to just quantify that for us and tell us what the next 7 years will look like in mobile gaming when we get back on This Week in Startups. All right, listen, I have a lot of development teams that I've worked with over the years, and I invest in a lot of companies, and I see what the contentious issues are, what the hot button issues are for developers. I can tell you what the hot button issue is. Who's on duty? Who's on what they call in the business pager duty, which means y'all going off and having a great time at Christmas and your birthday and July 4th, and the developers who are super critical to our businesses and who are, let's face it, our prized commodity, because all the problems in the world need to get solved by software. Software is eating the world. You have to treat those developers well, but they also have to be on duty because they're the only people who can fix things when they go down. You want to have no drama and you want to have an efficient system so you're not annoying developers with alerts and problems that are not major, but you are getting them to solve the issues that are when they're off duty or not off duty, on pager duty, which is on alert, like a doctor, right? And so what pager duty does is they do this all as software as a service. So you put all your different monitoring software into their cloud, stuff like New Relic and stuff like that, and whatever else you're using. And then they put all of those alerts into an iOS, Android app on the web, and they only alert you if it's important. And then they track who's on duty and who's not and all that kind of stuff. It keeps developers super happy. You shouldn't roll these kind of things yourself because it will cost you. I mean, people do try to. I've been in companies where they're like, oh, we're going to make a system for that. And then they go work 2 months on building pager duty, like 5% of it, and not as elegant, and it breaks. And then everybody's even more upset. Go use pager duty. It works. Developers love it. And actually, Chartbeat, Justin, the senior engineer over there at Chartbeat, which was one of my first angel investments, had this to say: pager duty gives Chartbeat one central place to send critical alerts. We now have a simple, easy process for on-call scheduling, right? This is Chartbeat. Chartbeat is a very successful business that I invested in. I was the first angel investor in it. Their clients are using their analytics software 24 hours a day, and they have some of the biggest clients in the world in the media business. Think of any big media company. They use it. Well, you know what? Chartbeat can't go down, or else it's like losing your analytics of your website. It's mission critical for people. Well, they need something like PagerDuty to make sure their developers are not getting bad alerts or getting good alerts and managing who's on, blah, 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 blah. You get the idea. You know what this is. You know you need it. If you have developers, you need it. Trust me. And you want to get rid of the drama that could cause a developer to leave. And developers will leave a company literally over something as stupid as, who's on duty in the paging system or the laptop they got or whatever, or when they hold the scrum meeting. Like, listen, developers are persnickety. These are smart individuals, and they have, core beliefs of how the world should work, and PagerDuty is how the world should work. So sign up today to get a 14-day free trial, pagerduty.com/twist, and you will get a free t-shirt with your first alert. That's pretty cool of them to give a free t-shirt to our users and our listeners. pagerduty.com/twist. Please go try the product. You will love it. And tell me what you think. And say thank you at PagerDuty on Twitter. Okay, let's get back to this amazing episode. Thank you, PagerDuty. Hey, everybody. Welcome back to This Week in Startups. It's Jason Calacanis. You can follow me on Twitter. I'm just at Jason. And you can follow Niccolo at Niccolo de Masi. And you can follow Glu at GluMobile and glu.com. All right, let me play another trailer here. And this is like, when I pulled up this trailer, I was like, sweet Jesus, my God, the quality of these graphics look like something from an Xbox circa not long ago.
Right.
What's happened in the last 5 years in terms of graphics? I mean, you said phenomenal, but let's quantify it a little bit more. Yeah. When we're using an iPhone 6 or the latest Samsung, what is that the equivalent of in console gaming or PC gaming? What year, maybe?
Most people would say they're sort of approximately the last generation of console, but that gap is closing because, of course, what's happening is Moore's Law is hitting every 2 years. And so when you pick up a tablet that shipped this year, mm-hmm. you're getting stuff that advanced and doubled approximately the last 18, 24 months, whereas the console cycle is much longer.
Right.
So if we're shipping last generation console with the 5S or the 6, within one Moore's Law cycle or two, so the next 2 years, 4 years, you probably are going to be up to the latest console generation in terms of raw GPU, CPU, RAM, ability to render, and pixel density, which is now greater than what the naked eye can probably see on a lot of these render displays. It's greater than it is on HDTV that you would play your console game on.
That is an interesting thing when you think about it. Like, Apple has now released the Retina displays.
Right.
In terms of the pixel density is so great.
Yep.
It's greater than humans' eyes can perceive.
Mm-hmm.
That's just phenomenal.
Well, most people. I mean, there are some people that can see the difference. Most people can see the difference for sure between Retina and an HDTV 1080p.
Yeah.
And that's why 4K and so on is coming out. But, these phones and tablets have already overtaken 1080p.
Why is that? Why have the phones and tablets eclipse the television sets and the densities because of smaller screen size? It's easier to do? Or
I think it's that Moore's Law cycle again.
Yeah.
Whereby, remember, I've been doing this 10 years, mobile media,
yeah.
and I've always said that people make handset decisions partially out of utility, partially out of fashion.
Mm-hmm.
And so there's a race, there's an arms right. race on between Samsung and Apple and LG and all these people and Sony to come out with the next latest greatest thing, just like the PC space
right.
was. So you have one-upmanship going on, and that pushes prices down and pushes functionality up.
Right.
And it's a very, very powerful trend. I mean, you know, no one can believe how unpowerful the first iPhone was that came out, you know, in June
yeah,
of 7 compared to where we are today.
When did Glu start putting games on the iPhone?
Well, we were at the start.
Yeah.
I mean, you know, we've been public since March 07, making cell phone games since 01. We've been through
Oh, wow. So you were doing trios and...
We were doing black and white snake picture, you know, snake games on a Nokia. I mean, we've been doing this 13 years in our 14th year. So we've seen every evolution of every platform.
Mm.
It's one of our institutional advantages is sort of thinking this through
right.
and making sure our games run on a very broad selection of devices.
What's going on with the current crop of consoles? I guess it's the Xbox One.
Mm-hmm.
And then what's the PlayStation called this time? I can't remember.
Is it 4?
PlayStation 4, I guess. So are people still buying those, or is that just like a small non-growing segment mm-hmm. of people? Because we do see like everybody playing games now, which is I think is a incredible phenomenon
yeah.
that people who were not playing video games for the last 20 years are now playing games.
Yep.
But are those console games shrinking, or they're static, or do you even monitor it? Or
yeah, we do. I mean, Glu increasingly thinks of itself as a gaming company, mm-hmm. not a mobile gaming company, because
okay.
of what you just said, which is that you know there's maybe 100 million households in the world that have bought a console in the last generation
mm-hmm.
or two. But I think the forecasts are to sell only about 70 million in the current cycle.
Mm-hmm.
And Sony's, I think, winning that market share.
Right.
Stand back and look at that, I always say. You know, there's 7 billion people in the world. There are probably 1.5 billion households in the world.
Right.
So that 70 to 100 million households at a console, that's a market, and that console market is going to be around longer than
yeah,
I think some
people thought. Yeah, 5 to 10% of the market. Yeah.
Exactly. But to me, the exciting question is, who is going to win in the living room for the next billion households?
Mm.
Not the current 100 million, but who wins the next billion living room devices?
Got it.
And our thesis is that Apple and Google are going to be fighting it out there with Microsoft and possibly Amazon,
mm.
because I don't think the future of the living room is 20 different boxes from cable companies and you know set-top boxes and plugins and like it's not that's not what it is. The majority of people, including myself and probably you, you know, go with simplicity, sensible price point, sensible PowerPoint, good user interface, clear, intuitive design.
Right.
Hasn't happened yet. And I think there's room for Apple, Google, or someone to crack that and capture
yeah.
a much, much, much bigger penetration that we have today with console.
And so you see the Apple TV, the Chromecast, my Samsung Smart Hub.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm not sure what Microsoft's offering is beyond the Xbox in the living room, but I do have actually. I have a Chromecast. I have Apple TV.
Right.
And I have
a smart TV, possibly.
The
as well.
Samsung yeah. I just bought off the wire
right.
cutter. Shout
right.
out Brian Lamb. Like I just bought the best one off there. When you hit the smart hub,
right.
I didn't realize it. You don't need Apple TV anymore.
Exactly. Well, that's true. You get Netflix. You get Amazon. You get Hulu. You get you know all sorts of stuff, right?
And in fact, what was really fascinating about it was I was able to load a web browser and then load video.
Mm-hmm.
It worked with all the major codecs on a web browser.
Yep.
Which, by the way, if you were somebody, you know, just wanting to stream Ustream or
yep.
something like that or other content, you can get it there. And Apple blocks Amazon on the Apple TV.
Right.
Which is so ridiculous because it's like I'm an Amazon Prime user and an Apple user and you're blocking them because they have a marketplace. It's really ridiculous.
Yep.
And so now I don't use my Apple TV anymore. I go right to the Samsung hub
yep.
by habit.
You can get everything from your cable company subscription that gives you HBO and Showtime
yeah.
basically and the rest is all on smart TVs
right.
basically. So, you know, it's hard given all the rights, overlapping rights, hardware power, you know, there's bandwidth.
Yeah.
Debates going on with net neutrality, all sorts of this big battle going on ultimately for control of the living room.
Right.
And I think it's going to take 10 years to play out. But I give people like Apple and Google probably a lot of credibility given their size alone to muscle their way in there in an innovative way potentially that thinks about growth rather than taking share from current players.
Got it. What do you think of the mobile phone in relation to the television set? In other words, you know, I've had this happen a number of times now. Somebody was over the house and they airplayed over to the TV.
Yep.
and they played something that they had in their library on my television set. And even further to that point, I now have an HDMI, maybe a 30-foot HDMI cable, and I put on the end of it this little adapter that Apple makes that lets you plug into a Lightning, mm-hmm. to an HDMI, so somebody can come over and either plug their laptop in or plug in their actual phone and not go over AirPlay and have a perfectly clear signal.
Yep.
Is this going to be my DVR? I'm holding my phone now for people just listening. But is this the game console and then it's going to play on the big TV? Is that the future?
Well, I do think personally that there is a great use case when you think about simple and a price point that, well, there's no better price point than you already have the device.
Right, zero.
But imagine the experience where, you know, you're an Apple, Google user, whatever, and your phone becomes your game controller, and you're just playing the same game, you know, over Wi-Fi or over some hockey puck on your living room device. You're playing your tablet, you're playing on your laptop, your desktop. That's a pretty powerful experience, especially if it's basically free.
Right.
Or $99, right?
Right.
So I think that kind of thinking, and Apple hasn't revealed this yet.
Right.
But ultimately, I would give them, and their $600 billion market cap and $100 billion of cash, you know, a lot of opportunity to chase payments aggressively, which they're doing.
Right.
And also chase, what's the disruptive experience in the living room?
They're clearly going to launch a television set. I mean, what do you think the odds are? 50-50?
I think 50-50 that they launch new hardware that changes the game. I don't know if it's TV or it's an expanded
Apple
hockey
TV,
puck plus something else. Because if you think about it, the hockey puck's already doing a lot of content rights.
Right.
If you can add gaming to that, and you can play, by the way, some Glu games over AirPlay on your TV.
Sure.
Tourney Warriors 2, Tourney Warriors 3, we enabled that. You can use your phone as your controller.
But because that is a specific piece of technology.
Yes,
what's that called where it like it mirrors? I mean, it's AirPlay, but.
Yeah, it's AirPlay mirroring. Yeah.
Yeah.
AirPlay
but mirroring. It knows, it's smart enough to know that when you AirPlay that game, which game is it?
Tourney Warriors.
Tourney Warriors.
I think it's Tourney Warriors 2 and 3 that we enabled that in.
Yeah. So it knows, you threw this up on an AirPlay TV.
Right.
That means your small screen is now the controller.
Correct.
And now you hit the fire button and you move around with this.
And it's really quite a good experience for your average casual gamer.
Yeah.
You know, I thought it was a brilliant experience. And I'm surprised it has yet to take off, you know, in a greater mass market way.
Right.
But I think Apple's testing has been testing things like that, like controllers.
Mm-hmm.
They're sort of waiting to see what the consumer behavior pattern probably is.
Yeah, they want to perfect it.
And they're going to keep locking up rights probably in the meantime.
Yeah.
But there's no doubt in my mind that if you are an Apple or a Google or a Microsoft or Amazon and you want to be the first $1 trillion market cap company the world's ever seen.
Right, which they will be.
Probably Apple will be at the rate they're going. They need to have one wallet, one consumer experience where you can take it to your phone, your tablet, living room device, desktop, laptop.
Any screen.
And it's got your music, your games, your movies, you know, your TV, all there with one account, 1 billion relationship.
Unbelievable.
And we're there. I mean, we're nearly there, right? You know, you're more than halfway there right now.
It feels like two-thirds, yeah. And what's really interesting is I never thought of them taking the hockey puck, i.e. the Apple TV, and putting a serious GPU in it. What is it called? They have the M7 or the M8, and then they have – what do they call the regular processor in here? I can't remember.
Well, there's that, and there's also improvements in, you know, in Wi-Fi technology all the time, right? So
we
get better at multi-threading. We get better at compression.
Yeah.
You know, I think one of the reasons that the mirroring didn't maybe take off, they said, there's a little bit of a lag.
It sucks.
A second or half a second, right?
Oh, my God, it sucks.
But it'll keep improving.
Yeah, that's the thing I've been shocked about is how bad Apple – TV is at mirroring, like we put it in conference rooms and then it's constantly lagging. And so then I was just like, you know what? I'm just going to run Ethernet cables in this $50 dongle. And literally when people come into the studio or my house or anywhere, we just plug in and it is crystal clear, perfect.
Yep.
But wow, that could be incredible if they had a hockey puck that had the processing power. Because it's almost like they have the Mac Mini over here.
Correct.
You have the iPhone 6 and then you have the Apple TV, which has the weakest processor.
Right.
And then I wonder if the Mac Mini, which has a stronger processor,
they've built
or the
a lot
iPhone
of cube-shaped computers in the past 10 years.
They did. I mean, Jobs was really into that
cube. They built a lot of cubes, and their new beast, you know, this sort of the tower, you know.
I have it.
Right.
And I'm super disappointed, and I actually tweeted to Tim because I was like, and the reason I'm disappointed is I buy this MacBook Pro.
Mm-hmm.
Mac Pro, right?
Mac Pro.
And it's like, it can support 4K monitors,
right?
Which we don't make.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm like, okay, that's ridiculous. I had to buy an Asus or whatever monitor, not hating on Asus, but I would like to have two cinema displays that would do 4K.
Right.
Then Apple does this mind-boggling thing. They release a Retina display iMac that's 5,000 pixels.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm like, well, why did I just spend $3,000 on the Mac Pro with no monitors when I could buy it's just they're sending these very weird signals and not telling people what's going to happen. But that's what leads me to believe that they will be they're going to do the TV. This is my belief. TV will be for Christmas next year.
Yep.
They launch it in the summer when they do the iPhone 6 refresh or something like that around that time period. They launch it in time to get it to you for Christmas. And it's a 5K Retina TV. So they just leapfrog the 4Ks and say, F it.
Could be.
Here's it's got a serious processor in it that can play games and an app store.
I think that give that a coin toss of a chance of happening. And probably, you know, it'll be a 64-bit gaming experience. Right?
Yeah.
So, you know, they do. These companies are really good at thinking on a 10-year view. Mm. Apple has a great track record to their credit of bringing things out that will support things farther in the future than you and I can imagine without sort of being in the mind of the architects. So maybe you should withhold judgment until you sort of see what comes, you know, next Christmas kind of thing.
Absolutely. Now, what about let me ask you about these future tech stuff. There's the Oculus Rift, which I put the first one on. I thought it was a terrible experience.
Yeah.
I haven't worn the second one, but my friend Chris Dixon, who was the investor who did it at Andreessen Horowitz, keeps telling me to reserve judgment.
Mm-hmm.
Have you used the Oculus Rift 1 and or 2? Which one have you used? And then what do you think that means for the future of gaming?
I have tried them both out. I can't remember which one we've got a developer kit on.
Probably the second
The second one.
Is the second one that much better?
Well, I do think Moore's Law applies to all of this stuff.
Yeah.
I mean, Glu, just sort of stand back and look at interesting new gaming platforms.
Yeah.
You know, we built the first Android game in 2008. Hmm. We also built the first Google Glass game last year.
How'd that go?
Well, same sort of experience in the sense that there isn't obviously a huge penetration of those devices yet.
Yeah.
So it's not a current money spinner. But what I always say to people that, you know, want to knock the current experience, remember what the first mobile phone was.
It was a suitcase. Yeah.
You used to open a suitcase up. Then you had a brick.
Yeah.
Right? And then look at where we are today, where mobile computing has been fully realized. And screens are actually getting bigger than they were at the peak of feature phones with the Razr and all that sort of stuff when it was voice-centric. So technology is really fascinating when you look at 10-year trends because of miniaturization, increases in power, decreases in price point.
Right.
No one's going to maybe, you know, see mass market takeoff of a Google Glass device if it costs $1,500.
Right.
But if it costs $99 and it was an option at LensCrafters to go on your, you know, sunglasses, very different penetration.
Yeah.
So the same will happen. And what's most exciting about Oculus and everything, and there's a few other companies that are also in the VR game, right?
Yeah.
There's a startup that Google's invested in. Obviously, Samsung's got a number of sort of plays on this thing. And that's all very healthy for the gaming market overall. It's always the same partners in my mind that are going to ultimately, that we're working with today, they're going to dominate gaming tomorrow. So Sony and Nintendo, in my mind, are dying platform partners. That's why Glu doesn't worry about them.
Right.
But we think Apple, Google, Samsung, Amazon, Microsoft, these are the guys that have the balance sheets, the user base, the clout,
right,
and they're trying to string together these ecosystems that do gaming plus all forms of content
together.
They have
to have it.
They have to have it, correct.
Right. They can't not have it because then they lose the platform war.
Correct. You can no longer say, you know, we're going to seed mobile. Like your 2020 plan involves, you know, mobile because, you know, and sort of come back to one of your early questions, gaming today has gone from mobile being a rounding error, part of the marketing department of a film or a console game, to today, you know, billion-dollar mobile games exist.
Which is incredible.
It's incredible. But it's
Candy Crush, Clash of Clans.
Correct.
Yeah.
You know, Puzzle & Dragon in Japan, probably another billion-dollar
Puzzle & Dragon, what's that? I never heard of that.
It's a game that a company called Gung Ho makes that's part-owned by, you know, Masayoshi Son and the SoftBank.
Oh, my pal at SoftBank, yeah.
Yeah, exactly. So, you know, you stand back and look at that and you go, there are big companies thinking about gaming, Tencent, Alibaba, Baidu, SoftBank.
Yeah.
People recognize that more consumer attention is going on these platforms and on gaming overall.
Mm-hmm.
But by the way, there's only about 1.5 billion smartphones in the world. And there's some tablets on top of that. And there are still 6 or 7 billion people.
Mm.
So this is still a market that can double or treble in terms of the installed base.
Right.
And engagement keeps increasing.
Yeah.
You know, 3/4 of the top grossing apps in the store, they're games. And that's showing no sign of abating.
Huh. It's pretty amazing. So is back to the Oculus thing. Okay, Moore's Law is happening. When do you think, I don't know, millions of people will have a VR headset? Like, I'm not saying critical mass. I'm saying there's an early adopter market. Obviously, Google Glass didn't get there.
Yeah.
But the watches are getting there, right?
So
there's a million watches.
Watches are going to get there because there's already 3 or 4 viable models in comparison. Yeah. I mean, LG, Samsung, Sony, Apple, like, they're all,
the
they're
Moto,
all in the mix,
yeah.
The Galaxy Gear, they're actually being used.
I mean, and they're good. I mean, I see civilians with them.
Correct. You see, that's a good sign. Yeah. So I think watches will go first. I think I'm more bullish that watches will be a 10 million consumer market a year, you know, over Google Glass and probably
VR. Are you
going
to make, when Kim Kardashian, when I don't, go to my audition, is Kim Kardashian going to come up on my phone and be like, hey, Jason, get your audition?
I think the phone is going to be the primary gaming device, followed by the tablet. Watches are going to be extenders. You're not going to play a game on a watch, but you are going to get notifications, and you're going to get ways of quickly interacting to keep pace with your base or whatever.
Right.
Google Glass can be both, actually.
Yeah.
And that's why we're excited about it. It could be just keep tabs on what's going on. It actually has enough going on with it that it's not a virtual reality system, but it's halfway there.
Right.
And it could be its own gaming platform in some ways.
Right.
Maybe in a future iteration of it.
Got it.
Virtual reality, I think, you're two Moore's Law cycles away.
Okay.
So I think 3-4 years from today, people will have a very different view of VR. The price points will be lower. It'll be more powerful. I mean, it'll probably be a 10 million, I think, ish market in sort of two Moore's Law cycles.
Which is why the smart folks at Andreessen Horowitz backed Oculus and the brilliant Mark Zuckerberg bought it.
Mm-hmm.
Because F it. If it winds up being the next big platform and Zuck bought it before everybody, it's going to cost him 10% of what he would have paid for it in 4 years. So it's a pretty good move.
Yep. Correct.
But for the watches, you think you're going to be putting some games on watches maybe next year?
Well, no, I think it's going to be an extension.
The alerts will come next year on games,
I think we will definitely be extending some games next year.
Yeah.
Really interested to see how the Apple take up is.
Yeah.
But they've put so much thought into that, and there's so much passion behind watches for Johnny Ives and so on, that I think you're going to see, really exciting liftoff there.
Mm.
And I'm sure they're just scratching the surface of what, of course, we're going to unveil year after year after year with that series, of new ways of interacting, new ways of messaging. There's so many things that Apple can do with payments and with messaging. Apple doesn't have a messaging play still.
Yeah.
And this whole company is like Tencent built around messaging.
It's weird, isn't it? Like the iMessage, they keep trying to make it a little bit better, but they seem to have lost the fundamental concept of a messaging platform, that it needs to be everywhere.
Right.
Why is there not Android iMessage? Why is there not Microsoft Android, Windows desktop iMessage? You have to be cross-platform. It's bizarre.
Well, you do, except Apple's so large and successful that they can play the long-term game of platform lock-in.
Yeah.
Right. And I think that they're willing to trade some short-term, success and revenues for the 10-year game of long-term lock-in on all their devices.
Right.
Because to their credit, they're doing well in China. Google's not doing business in China.
Right.
And so if you play that out 5 more years, 10 more years with all these devices together, Apple's got almost, 600-700 million iTunes accounts, something like that, and iPhones. I mean, they'll get to 1 billion.
Right.
And it's not only an aspirational brand, but they keep marching the price point down in emerging markets of older devices.
Right.
Learning their lessons from 20 years ago.
Right. They're like, hey, get the 5C, get the 5S.
Exactly. Well, look, the 3S is still an incredible device in a number of countries, right?
Oh, is it really? Yeah, they're still...
Well, I mean, it would be. Think about what else there is. I mean, remember, the world still has more feature phones than smartphones, believe it or not, in totality.
Right.
So the 3 or the 3S is still crushing any feature phone.
Right, of course. Right? Yeah. So you have a pretty international business. The majority of your employees are outside the U.S.?
Correct, yeah.
And the majority of your revenue or games, is that outside the U.S. as well, the players?
Yeah, I mean, we make probably a third, 30-40% of our revenue in North America, probably half to 60% in English.
Huh.
But most English-speaking countries are, Australia, New Zealand, the UK, Ireland, et cetera. So English is the majority because games like Deer Hunter, Contra Killer, Racing Rivals, and Kim Kardashian are four bigger ones.
Mm-hmm.
Those do sort of skew a little more towards English-speaking countries than, say, China or Korea. But games like Eternity Warriors do much better in China and Korea. And we build them in Beijing for an Asian audience.
You do?
We do. So, we build 12, 13, 14 games a year, something like that.
Wow.
And we have 4 or 5 genres that we're looking to dominate. Celebrity gaming obviously is there. Shooters are there with Deer Hunter and Contract Killer that you just showed.
Yeah.
We have the number one racing game, Racing Rivals.
Uh-huh.
We have the number one baseball game, Tap Sports Baseball.
Oh, who knew?
And we also have, we think the leading time management franchise with Diner Dash.
Got it. So now, about Chinese gamers,
mm-hmm.
how are they different? How is the Chinese market different in terms of gaming specifically? Or is it?
Well, here's what we found always. Yeah. China and Korea are a lot less different for our games and gamers and game types, certainly, than Japan, actually.
Okay.
So Japan is the is kind of the different universe or different island.
And anybody who's been to Japan can tell you that.
Like, yeah. I mean,
it is a unique place in the world.
It's been unique in all content sectors for probably, you know, the entire time we've been anyone's been having this conversation, and it works both ways. I mean, Japanese games don't crush it here, nor does their music, nor vice versa. If we, you know, Contra Killer that you just showed, that does well in China and Korea and the U.S. Doesn't do well in Japan, mystifyingly so.
They're not into guns. They got a thing about guns there.
But they come to the U.S. and go to Vegas and shoot the machine guns.
Yeah, exactly.
In love, kind of thing, right? So, you know, yes and no. And remember, there's a lot of Japanese console games that are plenty into guns. Time Crisis. I mean, they've invented a lot of these.
In PlayStation,
I actually put it more onto down to sort of nationalism around homegrown brands than I do about tastes. Because the same game built by, you know, domestic player versus foreign will get very different brand traction.
Right. So an American company trying to make a go of it in Japan, not very easy to do. But
for
China
anything.
And Korea, it's a little bit easier.
Absolutely. Yeah. I mean, China and Korea have been, you know, top three, four markets for us for a long time. You know, our four biggest offices are here, San Francisco, just outside Seattle, and then Moscow and Beijing.
And when you look at Beijing and the entrepreneurship scene there and the developers there, what's the difference? Like in terms of, you know, you have a team of developers there, a team of developers here, pound for pound, are they the equivalent? And in terms of, you know, ability to produce world-class product?
Well, it's certainly the most entrepreneurial nation on earth, I would argue, in a lot of ways right now, right? So, you know, the digital markets in China have been very entrepreneurial for well over a decade.
Yeah.
I mean, I used to work in the mobile music space before I got into gaming, and I've watched Chinese entrepreneurialism around wireless value-added services run for the last, you know, since 2001, actually.
Right.
You know, it was picture messaging, then ringtones and games, then, you know, now it's dating and e-commerce and, you know, search and you name it. They're very adept at learning from the West in a lot of ways, and then finding the right sinification of that. And then, and they have a lot of hybrid business models. You see a lot of digital entrepreneurs and business there that are a little bit of this plus this.
Yeah, stickers plus whatever.
Correct, and less pure play. So all the big Chinese internet companies, whether Alibaba, Baidu, you know, Tencent, they're all most worried about muscling into another digital business in China as opposed to being global, which is interesting. So they worry about their neighbor stealing their team and business before they go, let me sell my product in the U.S. in terms of priorities.
Right.
So, you know,
are any of them coming to the U.S. and operating here? Because you hear about that every year that, oh, Gree's got a little office or Rakuten or Naver or Daum might be doing something here. Like Daum actually bought Lycos at one point, had a little bit of an operation here.
Sure.
Any of those Asian companies, Korea, China, or Japan, doing anything significant here on American soil?
Significant, yes. Will it be half their business?
Yeah.
Not in the next, my guess is the next 10 years.
Right.
Because they're so competitive domestically.
Right.
And if you talk to a successful Chinese internet entrepreneur, you know, the biggest opportunity there is the fact that they've got 1.3 billion people, and there's still few hundred million of them have yet to get
a phone
or right, exactly. So like
you're living in on a farm.
You won't give up on that. A clear growth opportunity to chase after this crazy idea, you know, in another
country. 300 million people,
So what most of the bigger companies are doing, Alibaba, Tencent, you know, they have investment programs. You know, Alibaba, you know, is bought minority stakes in companies like Kabam. Tencent has bought, I think, even majority stakes now in businesses like Riot.
Right.
League of Legends, the biggest MMO arguably in North America after, alongside or after or before World of Warcraft, hard to tell. So they're going to get more of their revenue internationally because they're so big now. They have $150 billion market caps.
Yeah.
Tencent and Alibaba, right?
Yeah, they have a currency.
Their currency, you know, they have plenty of access to capital. They're going to keep expanding, but I think it's going to be inorganic expansion. They're going to have the most success taking minority and majority stakes, I think, with successful existing businesses in the U.S.
Yeah.
over setting an office up and saying, we're going to import a bunch of people.
This is what I'm fascinated by is that the Asian companies, you know, are now, you know, because of Alibaba, it's like, why would I leave China to go to America and try to be an internet entrepreneur? It's like, I've got such a huge opportunity here.
Correct.
And it can be done. I mean, that's what Jack Ma taught everybody.
Yep.
Obviously, Masayoshi-san taught everybody long ago that you could do it there, but it's really been slammed home now. Let me ask you a final question about this celebrity game. you have things like Who Wants to Be a Millionaire, like these reality shows, or Dragon's Den and Shark Tank. Yeah. They become international franchises, and I think Who Wants to Be a Millionaire might have been in like, you know, 50 countries or something. There's a Kim Kardashian in every country. There's somebody who's the equivalent of her. Have you done one in another country, and is that going to be the roadmap? Is, hey, you know, who in London, who in Delhi, who in Beijing, who in Tokyo is the Kim Kardashian equivalent?
We have that debate constantly at a company like Glu that is so global.
Yeah.
And you can have the same debate on every genre. It's not just celebrity. It's, you know, how would you build this action RPG for the U.S. versus China or Korea? You know, the U.S., you would want Greco-Roman Sparta stuff. You want the Six Kingdoms in China. Mm-hmm. And in Japan, you want samurais or something, right? So localization is a really pertinent and constant topic for us.
Yeah.
It's true for celebrities. It's also true for even the features that people like in every single genre. So at the moment, we're in a stage whereby there's 1.5 billion smartphones going to 3, 4, 5 billion. We think the right strategy is to build all of our games for the globe.
Mm-hmm.
So we do localization around languages. We launch our games in 12 languages. We do local marketing. We might start to do local events. But we haven't yet actually built a game just for one country.
Got it. So Kim Kardashian is in China or is in Japan and is being translated?
So translation's challenging in a game that has, frankly, an entire novel of text in it already.
Yeah.
And we add to it every 2 weeks with Kim.
Yeah.
So we'll be trying probably other languages that she has a bigger fan base in, like maybe Spanish would be first. You know, China, the reason I love my partnership with Kim so much is I think we're just getting started with where she can go. Mm-hmm. She's building her brand overseas. We're going to be able to grow and help her grow alongside
that. She took over Paris for Fashion Week.
Exactly. But she's just really getting started. When you stand back and look at where most of the sort of revenue from our game comes, it's English. Her show is in 140 countries, I think, or 113 countries.
I wasn't aware.
But ultimately, I would say that, you know, you're probably going English, then sort of Latin America, and I think Asia is still newish for her. I mean, she's big in India, but I think that she can do a lot with her brand in the Middle East, Africa, and East Asia.
She's very big in the Middle East,
She's very popular in Dubai.
Persian, right? And she's half.
She's Armenian.
All right. Listen. You're a smart dude. I mean, it's great having you on the program. I feel like I'm smarter like after just an hour with you. Continued success with the company, and I'm assuming you're hiring developers here in America and all kinds of things. It's a great company to work for. Obviously, they're on a tear. So if you're a developer or something, go work at Glu Mobile. I mean, gosh. Why do you think Zynga failed? Let me ask you that question. Why do you think they imploded? I mean, they haven't really failed, but they've had problems. What do you think their mistakes were? I forgot that I was going to ask you that.
Yeah, I mean, look, the game.
And I'm friends with Mark Pincus, you know, like
right.
A good friend.
I mean, the game's. I don't think it's failed. I think it's a company that's going through a platform transition.
Ah.
And I know a lot about platform transitions. I've been through two of them myself, right? And they are tricky. They take longer than people think. What I mean by platform transition, to be clear, is a big revenue stream or business model or source of, you know, income that is declining in small percentage terms, but from a big absolute number.
Right.
And a thing that's small in absolute numbers, in absolute terms, it's growing in big percentage terms.
Got it.
And what tends to happen, and Glu had the same thing when I joined, feature phone revenues were going from, you know, $100 million to zero.
Right.
And I needed to build a new smartphone revenue business.
Painful.
It is painful. And for them, it's Facebook, Canvas has been shrinking, mobile's been growing. And there's sort of what I call this dust bowl that you go through with any platform transition, whereby you're taking cash flow from the old thing, you're investing in the new business. And at some point, the whole company grows when the new thing is bigger in absolute terms than the old thing. It crosses.
Right, they cross and you get that little bowl.
Right, but until it crosses, people say the company's failed or failing. You know,
right.
When I started Glu, we had a $30 million market cap. You know, today it's over $400 million. Right. We were running out of cash when I started. We're guided to finish the year with $70 million or more of net cash.
Yeah.
You know, Zynga, to its credit, hasn't really burnt much cash since public. Yeah. It's still got about $1 billion.
Yeah. And they own the building, which I think is worth $1 billion. That was the other thing.
Certainly worth at least half that, I would think.
Right.
And, you know, they've got Don now, who was, you know, with Mark, is obviously growing the, they're focusing on the mobile business.
Yeah.
And I wouldn't discount also a resurgence for Facebook, by the way. I think that Facebook has been a really great partner for game companies, not only in the early days of, you know, Facebook gaming online on the canvas,
right,
but if you look at their mobile business.
Installs.
Installs, advertising. I mean, they're intricately wound up with the gaming industry. Right. And I would say that they're and arguably one of the most aligned partners we have, in the sense that they only bring things out that work, mm-hmm. or, you know, not sort of early beta testing and might be ready in a year. Facebook hits their dates. They bring stuff out. It works. They're aligned with us in helping us market, monetize, reach new users. And I think they're just getting started on that. And I would be surprised if they couldn't apply some of their power from mobile back to the online space.
Yeah, that'd be very interesting to see, because they were, when Chamath was there, they were trying to figure out, hey, do we do our own platform?
Right.
Do we fork Android?
Right.
Do we make our own OS? Do we buy BlackBerry? Do we buy Palm?
And they made the right call, right? Like, partner with Apple, don't compete with Apple. You know, I think it's been a great, great idea for both companies, unlike the relationship between Facebook and Google, which, you know, has been more acrimonious ultimately and more competitive.
Right, and they don't have an app store anymore, really, Facebook. And they lost the app business, but they gained the app install business.
Exactly. Well, don't need it. I mean, they've gained the whole mobile advertising business. And they're going to become, I mean, think about Facebook. They have a chance to become a mobile ad network and a mobile identity.
Right.
An internet identity, ultimately.
Yeah.
You know, Facebook, login, connect, plus advertising, they know more about more users and their behavior, and they have more users than any other ad network I can think of.
Yeah. But they, my understanding is in Asia, I think it might be Gree or these other platforms, mm-hmm. or what's the big messaging one? Naver has Line, I guess.
Yeah, there's
Line.
There's Kakao out of Korea, and there's Line,
And then there's Gree and some other ones. But Gree's more gaming, not
Gree's
communication.
Gree's gaming platform attempt, although I think that quite honestly is, you know.
But they're putting games into Line, and they're putting games into the other ones. So
there's Tencent's the other big messaging platform, WeChat, you know, in China.
WeChat is the one that has games in it as well.
Yep.
So do you see a future where Facebook could put a game inside the Facebook app somehow? Like embed an
they can. The big this goes back to our comment, you know, earlier in this program where we're talking about purity of business model.
Right.
So, you know, Steve Jobs was always about a company doing what they can do best, just do that.
Yeah.
And Disney was separate from Pixar, it was sort of separate from, you know, Apple.
Yeah.
Facebook's taking that approach in my mind, whereby they're sort of purists. We're going to be this ad platform, we're gonna be this messaging platform, we're not gonna be a game company, we're not gonna be a phone company, we're not gonna be a, you know, an operating system. The Chinese companies, as I was saying, they're much more inclined to jumble this up and find a way to do a little bit of everything.
Yeah.
And it's their version of lock-in in a lot of ways. You know, Tencent's the biggest messaging platform, the biggest gaming platform, and they think about now e-commerce and competing with Alibaba.
Right.
You know,
we're going to put an eBay in here, and we're going to put an Amazon in here.
And you have Xiaomi, which is, of course, this really exciting handset company coming out of China.
Yeah. Yuri's putting $1 billion into that or something crazy.
Absolutely. And they're making their money. They're kind of a free-to-play company. You know, effectively disguised as a handset company, right? Where they're sort of giving handsets away at cheap prices, making money on services. And
I didn't
everything.
Know that was their model. That's
it's a big piece of the model. Right?
Yeah.
And they're going to make their money on gaming and messaging, all sorts of things. Ultimately.
So Samsung's got to be like, oh my God, we got to really catch up here and we got to monetize that way. They're almost Googling them, where they're like, what Google did to Microsoft.
It's the Amazon model, but they're frankly, you know, they're certainly more successful in China, Xiaomi, than Amazon is in terms of subsidized hardware with services. I think as a thought process. And, you know, Xiaomi is picking up great talent. So that could be a global business, actually.
I kind of, you know, I went to Korea and Japan and China like every year for 2 or 3 years, but I haven't been there in like 4 years. I got to get over there and just hang out. And I met with Naver and Daum and these companies. Like, man, are they studying what's going on here? And they're super innovative and just really interesting, the consumer behavior of like people reading news over there and just really into it. So being you guys are public, is this a pain in the ass to be public, huh?
It's my second public company, Glu, actually. Second public company, second games company, third mobile media company in the last 10 years.
Yeah.
And I think, you know, public.
You like being public? Is it hard as an entrepreneur?
You know, certainly when things are extremely challenged, you have to be Dust Bowl. You got to be a mindset of transparency, and using the quarterly calendar as a forcing function for good.
Right.
So, you know, the world is full of entrepreneurs that complain about, oh, it's so hard to turn around a company when it's public, and you know, valuation. Probably you get more punishment in that trough being public than being private. Right? Because you can't talk as much about where you could be as you might negotiate when you're private.
Yeah.
But, you know, to be honest, I find that the discipline of having to be clear, transparent, and on a calendar, if you are adept and experienced at operating a public company and all the machinery around that, if you have that in good shape,
right,
then it actually can be a pillar of strength for being transparent with your own employees, reporting the results, showing people that action means something on time, and it actually has a clear impact. Mm-hmm. So I've always I've turned around two public companies, and I've always used this as sort of a cornerstone of the foundation for the rebuild, and very much tried to sort of capitalize on that clock, as opposed to whine about it. To be honest.
Right.
We having a liquid currency is great. You can be a consolidator. Yeah. You can issue stock to buy businesses. You can raise capital quickly.
Right.
Glu's raised money maybe four times since I've been there.
Right.
And we can do it in 3 days.
That's
It's not a month-long process of going and seeing people that might or might not invest.
Right.
Kind of thing. But I will say, a lot better being public on the NASDAQ than being on any other exchange in the world.
Yeah. You're NASDAQ?
We're on the NASDAQ.
NASDAQ
and NYC for tech companies, unbeatable understanding by investors, and unbeatable liquidity, frankly, and depth to the markets.
Yeah, because you have so many investors there who are savvy, and it's like...
And it's got the toughest regulation in the world. People don't appreciate... We have NASDAQ rules, SEC rules, right?
Yeah.
And Starbucks rules.
Right.
But all of that leads to trust.
Right.
So you can raise money on the phone with people that you've never met before because of all this regulation.
Right. What percentage of a NASDAQ CEO's time do you think is managing the street, like on a percentage basis, yours or others on average? 10%, 30%?
Yeah, I mean, it depends how adept you are at it.
Okay.
So experience
Well, now you're
matters.
Good at it, right?
Yeah, if you're good at it, it's part of the quarterly routine. And by the way, when I say good at it, it's not just about me, it's about
the
our
team.
CFO, the team, and sort of what that clock looks like. Look, there's no doubt that there's 10 to 20% probably of your thinking time that goes in the quarter to earnings calls, earning call preparation, you're filing quarterly accounts. You are thinking about how to message not only the next quarter, but the next year, and maybe the long term. But when you roll all that back, once you're a well-oiled machine, and I've been doing this for, five, six, 7 years as a public company CEO. Actually, I guess I'm heading my seventh or eighth year actually overall.
Yeah.
Probably eighth year, come to think of it. I think it's down to 10% once you're a well-oiled machine.
Right.
Because all the other stuff that's on top of the 10%, you have to do it anyway.
Yeah, it's like discipline you'd have to do anyway.
You got to communicate. You got to think of the long term.
It's a framework.
It's a framework, right. You need to, analyst days are good. They force you to think about what you should be talking about strategically for your team, your board, external investors. I think it's its own skill set. People don't appreciate that no matter how amazing you are, when you run a public company the first time, it doesn't matter if you were really successful at Google or Apple or Yahoo. Like, if you come from a big company, you weren't the top dude. You didn't have to do that. And so there's a learning curve. And so I would always say, regardless of whether or not you were a superhuman at a private company, you haven't done this before, there's probably a year of getting used to the machinery and the clock and how it all comes together.
Yeah.
And it's a real skill set like anything else. You get better at it.
Yeah.
I'm definitely a lot better at it this time than first time around.
Well, listen, this has been an amazing hour and 15 now with Niccolo. Everybody follow Glu Mobile. Everybody try the games. Lots of best of games on tons of lists. You can go check out glu.com and you'll see all that. Contract Killer, Dino Hunter, Deer Hunter. I see. Why is Deer Hunter such a phenomenon? What is that? Is that the people in the South buy it? Is that like something that appeals to like guys? I mean, I remember Deer Hunter from 10, 20 years ago. I was like, something is very.
Yeah, so we bought the brand off of Atari in 2012.
Oh, yeah, Atari.
It is a brand that's been going since 97.
Yeah.
It's a global phenomenon. We announced we'd done 120 million installs of Deer Hunter 2014 in the first, I think, 12 and a half, 13 months. So it's more female than you think. It's more global than you think. It's more, it's English-speaking countries, but it's also Russia and China, all sorts of countries that don't have a hunting culture. So it's a very primeval experience. You know, shooting deer in the head, I think, ultimately is probably the world's second oldest profession.
Right.
Right.
Yeah, you're going to need to eat something for dinner.
Exactly.
Go ahead and get some deer.
And it's a great game that we've managed to simplify to the point whereby it can be enjoyed by a wide range of player types. So in your sort of talk earlier about people that are playing games never done before, played before.
Yeah.
A lot of those players are playing games like Deer Hunter. Short sessions.
You got the bejeweled.
Play for a minute.
People.
Yeah, it's the bejeweled hunting.
Yeah.
In a lot of ways.
Bejeweled
and so
hunting.
That brand keeps getting bigger for us every time we launch it.
It is amazing. It's got like a, it's almost like kitschy in a way. Like I remember seeing the boxes back when there was packaged software. You always saw the boxes.
Right.
I think the boxes were done so well, people bought it. And then the gameplay seemed to be pretty good.
That's a great example of us taking an existing brand, making it work in the free-to-play mobile world, and then growing it.
Yeah.
And we intend to do that with actually all of our brands.
Who owns the Atari assets now? It's some French company, right?
Well, they went bust.
Yeah.
And somebody, I think various people have been on various pieces. We bought this about a year before they went bust.
God, I wonder who owns the actual name Atari.
Yeah, I'm not sure. The receiver probably maybe hasn't sold it yet.
Who knows? I think it's a French company. It's got it locked up.
It was a French-listed company, actually, towards the last 5 years.
I had Nolan Bushnell on, the founder, on the show, I don't know, 2 years ago, 3 years ago. It was just great to hear the stories of like him having
incredible stories.
Steve Jobs and Wozniak working for him.
Yeah, exactly. Incredible stories.
Pong and stuff
incredible
like that.
Incredible stories.
Incredible.
Gaming's been intertwined in technology from the beginning.
Absolutely. All right, listen, this has been an amazing hour. Niccolo, continued success, and thanks to our sponsors and everybody else. And hey, let me just take a moment at the end of the program to give a quick shout out to one of my portfolio companies, Home Hero. If you don't know about this, myself and Chamath just did the last round of investing in it. It is the fastest and most affordable way to find in-home care for seniors. In other words, it's Uber what's the other one? It's like dog vacay or Uber. If you need a home attendant for your mom or your dad and they're old and you need somebody to go over there, right? But they made it on a smartphone. They made it a marketplace. They have reviews. It's all like perfectly done, so you can trust the people who are going to go take care of your parents or whatever. It's only operating in Los Angeles, but for my friends who are in Los Angeles, go to homehero.org/redeem and use the code TWIST100 for $100 credit. And I really would like people, if they use homehero.org, to just email me directly, jason@inside.com or jason@launch.co, and just tell me what they thought of the experience, because obviously it's an investment that I have high hopes for. homehero.org/redeem. Use TWIST100. Great company in LA. Actually, if you're a developer looking for work too, another great place to work is Home Hero. You can follow them on Twitter, Home Hero. And we'll see you all next time on This Week in Startups. Bye-bye.